This is Concept E Classes, and today we'll deal with Chapter 5 of Class 8 History, When People Rebel, 1857 and After. So first in this chapter, we'll discuss about how the policies and the laws made by the East India Company affected the people. And because of all these policies and taxes and laws, a mutiny started and how it became a popular rebellion. And that rebellion was the revolt of 1857. Then how the company fought back against this rebellion and the aftermath of the revolt of 1857 or the changes in the colonial rule after 1857. So that's what we are going to study in this chapter. So the first topic is policies and the people. So let's discuss how these people were affected by the policies made by East India Company. The Indian kings, the Nawabs, queens, peasants, landlords, the tribals, soldiers, they were all affected in different ways by the policies of East India Company. We saw some of the policies in chapter 2, like the subsidiary alliance, the doctrine of labs. So all these people, they started resisting against these Britishers as these policies and actions were against their rights as well as sentiments. So before we enter into the resistance of the people, let's see the effect of the policies on Nawabs, the peasants and sepoys, and the responses to reforms. So first let's see how the Nawabs were affected by these policies. Since the mid 18th centuries, the Nawabs, the Rajas, they had lost their power, the authority and honor. For example, the residents, they had been appointed in many states. The freedom of these rulers had been reduced. Their armed forces had been disbanded and their revenues and territories had been taken away. Even many ruling families, they tried to negotiate with the company to protect their interest. For example, Rani Lakshmi Bai of Jhansi. She wanted the company to recognize her adopted son as the heir of the kingdom after her husband's death. Similarly, Nana Sahib, the adopted son of Peshwa Baji Rao, he pleaded that he should be given his father's pension when the latter died. However, the company was very confident of his power. They turned out all these pleas. Similarly, Awadh. Do you remember that we have studied about Awadh? It was the region in the modern Indian state of Uttar Pradesh. It was the last territory to be annexed. And in 1801, a subsidiary alliance was imposed on Awadh. We have studied about subsidiary alliance in chapter 2. Do you remember? That is, it was a law, a policy where the Indian rulers were not allowed to have their own army. They have to keep the company's army and pay their maintenance. And if they fail to do so, their territory will be taken away as a penalty. So in 1856, the Awadh was taken over by the Governor General, Lord Dalhousie, as he declared that this territory was being misgoverned and the British rule was needed to ensure proper administration. So from all these instances, we can understand how the Nawabs have lost their power. So the company, they even wanted to bring down the Mughal dynasty to end. So what did they do? The name of the Mughal king was removed from the coins minted by the company. See, on this coin, we can see the name of the East India Company. In 1849, Governor General Dalhousie, he announced that after the death of Bahadur Shah Zafar, the family of the king would be shifted out of the Red Fort and given another place in Delhi to reside in. And Governor General Canning, he decided that Bahadur Shah Zafar would be the last Mughal king. And after his death, none of his descendants or sons would be recognized as king and they would just be princes. So in such a way, the company, they established their rule through all these policies and laws. So now let's see how the peasants and sepoys were affected by these policies. Now in the countryside, the peasants and zamindars, they hated these rigid methods of revenue collection. Many even failed to pay back their loans to the money lenders and they gradually lost their land which they have tilled for generations. The Indian sepoys as well in the employ of the company also had the reasons of discontent. Their pay, the allowances and the conditions of services was the reason why they were unhappy. And some of the new rules it violated their religious sensibilities and beliefs. For example, in that time, the people believed that if they crossed the sea, they would lose their religion, caste. So, in 1824, the sepoys were told to go to Burma to fight for the company by sea route, they refused to follow the order, though they agreed that they will go by land route, but they were severely punished. In 1856, the company passed a new law stating that every new Indian person who is employed in the company's army had to agree to serve the overseas if required. So all these rules, they violated their religious beliefs, and the sepoys also reacted to what was happening in the countryside, because many of them were peasants and they had their families living in villages. So the anger of these peasants, it quickly spread among the sepoys. This is an image of how the sepoys of the Bengal army, they exchange news and rumors of in the bazaars of North India. Now let's see the responses to reforms. Now the British believed that the Indian society had to be changed or reformed. So they passed certain laws. Laws were passed to stop the practice of sati and to encourage the remarriage of widows. Now the sati was actually a practice where the widows were burned alive with their deceased husbands. So the Britishers made laws to stop this practice of sati and encourage the remarriage of widows. English language education was actively promoted. After 1830, the company allowed the Christian missionaries to function freely in its domain and even own land and property. In 1850, a new law was passed to make the conversion of Christianity easier. Now, what was that law? This law, it allowed an Indian who had converted to Christianity to inherit the property of his or her ancestors. That is, this law stated that if an Indian is converted to Christianity, he could inherit the property of his ancestors. Now, many Indians began to feel that the Britishers were destroying their religion, their social customs and culture. So, they started rebelling against these policies. So the next topic is a mutiny becomes a popular rebellion. Now what do you mean by mutiny? When the soldiers as a group disobey their officers in the army, it is said to be a mutiny. So in this topic, we'll discuss how the mutiny started and how it became a popular rebellion. Now over time, a large number of people started resisting and they began to believe that they have a common enemy, which were the Britishers. And they should be united to rise up against the company rule. Such a situation actually developed in the northern parts of India in 1857, where the sepoys mutinied, starting from Meerut. Now the Britishers, they faced a massive rebellion, which started in May 1857, and this rebellion threatened the company's very presence in India. Some even regarded this rebellion as the biggest armed resistance to colonialism in the 19th century anywhere in the world. So let's now discuss how the rebellion started from Meerut to Delhi. On 29th March 1857, a young soldier named Mangal Pandey was hanged to death for attacking his officers in Barakpur. And some days later, after this incident, some sepoys at Meerut refused to do the army drill using the new cartridges, which was suspected of being coated with the fats of cows and pigs, because most of the sepoys were Hindus and Muslims and this was against their religious beliefs. So 85 sepoys were dismissed from the service and sentenced to 10 years in jail for disobeying their officers. So this happened in 9th May 1857. So the sepoys and the Indian soldiers, they were very angry, and in order to bring an end to the company's rule, on 10th May, they marched to the jail in Meerut and released the imprisoned sepoys. This is an image where the rebel sepoys, they attacked and killed the British officers. And they captured the guns and ammunition. They even set fire to the buildings and properties of the British and declared war on the Firangis. The Firangi is a term used for the foreigners. So after this, the Indian sepoys, they reached Delhi and they were joined by the regiment of Delhi and together rose up in rebellion. Now this is an image where a battle took place at the K cavalry lines. About 3,000 rebels on 3rd July 1857 crossed the river Jamuna, entered Delhi and attacked the British cavalry post. Once again, the British officers were killed. They seized the arms and ammunition of the Britishers and set the building on fire. Finally, they met the Mughal Emperor Bahadur Shah Zafar and proclaimed him as their leader. Now, initially, the aging emperor was not quite willing to challenge this mighty British power, but the soldiers persisted. Finally, he accepted this and wrote letters to various kings to organize a confederacy of Indian states to fight against the British. This single step taken by Bahadur Shah Zafar had very great implications. The Mughal dynasty actually ruled over a large part of the country. So many small rulers, they believed that they could stop this British rule if the Mughal emperor could rule again. So the Mughal emperor, they got support from the rulers, the chiefs of the country, and together they rose against the British power. The British actually had not expected this to happen. Then the rebellion started spreading. So after the British were routed from Delhi, there was no uprising for almost a week because it took much time for the news to travel. Then a spurt of mutinies began. Regiment after regiment mutinied and took to join other groups, especially at nodal points like Delhi, Kanpur and Lucknow. And along with the local leaders and zamindars, many peoples of the towns and villages also rose up in rebellion against the Britishers. So this is a map where all the rebellion have spread. Now at Kanpur, Nana Sahib, the adopted son of late Peshwa Baji Rao, gathered armed forces, expelled the British garrison from the city, and he proclaimed himself as Peshwa. He even declared that he was a governor under the Emperor Bahadur Shah Zafar. Now this was the army of Nana Sahib and Tantiya Top. Now let's see the rebellion in Lucknow. Now Mirjis Kadir, the son of the deposed Nawab Wajid Ali Khan, was proclaimed the new Nawab. He too acknowledged the dynasty of Bahadur Shah Zafar. His mother Begum Hasrat Mahal took an active part in organizing the uprising against the British. Now this is a painting where Lucknow was seized from the Britishers. In Jhansi, Rani Lakshmi Bai, she joined the rebel sepoys and fought the Britishers along with Tantiya Tope, the general of Nana Sahib. So this was the army of Tantiya Tope. In Madhya Pradesh, in the Mandla region, Rani Avantibai Lodi of Ramgarh raised and led an army of 4,000 against the British who had taken over the administration of her state. Now other than these leaders, many new leaders also came up. For example, Ahmadullah Shah, a Maulvi from Faizabad, raised a huge force of supporters and came to Lucknow to fight against the British. In Delhi, a large number of Ghazis or religious warriors, they came together to wipe out the white people. The Bakht Khan, a soldier from Bareilly, took charge of large force of fighters who came to Delhi and he became the key military leader of the rebellion. In Bihar, an old zamindar, Kunwar Singh, joined the rebel sepoys and battled with the British for many months. So let's see how the Britishers faced this rebellion. The Britishers were greatly outnumbered by rebel forces. They were killed, their buildings were set on fire, they were defeated in number of battles. And on 6th August 1857, a telegram was sent by Lieutenant Colonel Tytler to his commander-in-chief, expressing the fear felt by British. And in that telegram, it stated that their men were cowed by numbers opposed to them and endless fighting. Every village is held against us and the zamindars have risen to oppose us. So this telegram indicates how much fear was felt by the British. So the company decided to fight back with all their might. The company wanted to repress the revolt completely. So they brought reinforcement from England and passed new laws to convict the rebels easily. Then they moved to the main centers of revolt. First, they captured Delhi and in 1857. So this was actually the image where the British forces attacked the rebels who had occupied the Red Fort. The recapture of Delhi, however, did not mean that the rebellion died down after that. The Britishers, they had to fight for 2 years to suppress the massive forces of the popular rebellion. Now let's see how the different states were captured. Now Delhi was recaptured from the rebel forces in September 1857. The last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar, was tried in court and sentenced to life imprisonment. He and his wife Begum Zinat Mahal were sent to prison in Rangoon in October 1858, and Bahadur Shah Zafar died in the Rangoon jail in November 1862. Now Lucknow was taken in March 1858 by General Havelock. Jhansi Rani Lakshmibai was defeated and killed in June 1858. A similar fate awaited Rani Avantibai in Madhya Pradesh, who after initial victory in Keri chose to embrace death when surrounded by Britishers on all sides. Now, this was actually the painting by the Britishers that depicted how the British forces captured the rebels near Kanpur. Tantya Tope, he escaped to the jungles of central India and continued to fight a guerrilla war with the support of the tribal and peasant leaders, but he too was captured, tried and killed in April 1859. So just as the victory against the British had earlier encouraged rebellion, the defeat of these rebel forces encouraged desertions. And the British also tried their best to win back the loyalty of the people. How? They announced rewards for the loyal landowners, saying that they would be allowed to continue there and enjoy their traditional rights over their land. Those who had rebelled were told that if they submit to the British, they would not be killed. Nevertheless, hundreds of sepoys, rebels, nawabs and rajas were tried and hanged during this time period. So till now, we saw how the mutiny started and how it spread among the different states of India, how the people rebelled against it and how the company fought back. Now let's discuss about the aftermath of this revolt of 1857, or what happened after 1857. Now the British, they had regained control of the country by the end of 1859, but they could not carry on ruling the land with the same policies anymore. They had to change these policies. So the major changes introduced by the British after the revolt of 1857 are: the British Parliament passed a new act in 1858 and transferred the powers of the East India Company to the British Crown. So East India Company no longer could rule India. All the Indian territories were under the direct responsibility of the British government. A member of the British cabinet was appointed as a secretary of the state, and he was made responsible for all the matters related to the governance of India. And he was given a team of experts called as the Indian Council to advise him. The Governor General of India was given the title of Viceroy, which was a personal representative of the Crown. Secondly, all the ruling chiefs of the country, they were assured that the territory would never be annexed in the future or never be seized or captured in the future. And they were even allowed to pass on their kingdoms to their heirs, including adopted sons. But they were made to acknowledge the British Queen as a sovereign paramount. Thus, the Indian rulers, they were allowed to hold their kingdoms as the subordinates of the British Crown. Now thirdly, it was decided that the proportion of the Indian soldiers in the army would be reduced and the number of European soldiers would be increased. So the Britishers, they feared that sometimes a mutiny might happen again. So they reduced the number of Indian soldiers in the army and increased the number of European soldiers. And instead of recruiting soldiers from Awadh, Bihar, Central India and South India, more soldiers was recruited from Gurkhas, Sikhs and Pathans. Now the land and property of the Muslims were confiscated on a large scale and they were treated with suspicion and hostility because the Britishers believed that they were responsible for the rebellion in a big way. Now the Britishers also decided to respect the customs, the religions and social practices of the people in India, and policies were made to protect the landlords, the zamindars, and give them security of rights over their lands. So from all these changes, we could understand that a new phase of history began after 1857. Now this is a map depicting the main centers of revolt. The red color shows the main centers. We have Delhi, Meerut, Jhansi, Lucknow, and the black triangle shows the other centers of revolt. So this revolt of 1857 was considered as the first war of independence. So that's all for chapter 5. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.